Almighty Father, you want us to return to the old time religion, old time Christianity, the one introduced to the apostles, practiced by the apostles, the one handed over by the apostles. God, we have asked, give it unto us. Yeah. I'm so grateful how much this Bible study teaching today will contribute to that in our lives. Yeah. I'm so grateful. Pour your grace upon us, yeah, both the preacher and the hearer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Last Tuesday, I introduced you to the prayer answering God, or else the God that answers prayers. I told you, prayer answering is one of the attributes, characteristics, nature of God. And that's why he does not automatically give us things always. No. He reserves some things to be done only in answer to prayers. So that when he does those things, his nature can be revealed to us better. You will say, ah, God is there. I saw him in the wonders he did in my life. God is ready, waiting for you, for all your desires, all your battles, all your plans, and all that you should bring them to him and tell him. So that when he gets involved, you will know you are dealing with the living God. You will give testimony to his glory. What happened? Jesus was in the ship with the disciples. He was sleeping in the lower part, in the hinter part of the ship. And there was a great storm against them. Why did God the Father allowed it? He wanted them to know God, the Son, that was with them. Things should not be automatically going well for you without your praying. He wanted God, the Son, to be manifested in a way that will convince the disciples he was no ordinary man, but God. So, as the wind was blowing boisterously, they woke him up. They first applied their energy, and when it fell, they woke him up. They woke him up with a kind of a rebuke. Master, don't you care that we're perishing? I'm waiting for that. You have been using your energy. I want you to come to the point you realize the person that is with you, the person that you go about with, the person you call Lord and God, the person that you are serving. I left that to wait for you to tap that. Because the impression you're going to have will remain with you forever. Then he arose and rebuked the wind and said unto the wave, peace, be still. Come on, calm down. Suddenly, there was a great calm. And the people started looking one to another. Who is this man that even the sea and the wind obey him? They had walked with him for at least more than a year. They thought they knew him. But prayer answering, peculiar prayer answering, caused a new revelation of God to them. And God wants, he has left some areas abandoned, as if abandoned them in your life, so that when you come to him in prayer, the peculiar prayer answering work of God will leave a permanent print in your heart. You won't forget him. Oh, thou that answerest prayer. Let's go there again. But this time, let's go there and oh, thou that answerest prayer. Psalm 65, verse 2. Psalm 65, verse 2. Oh, thou that hearest prayer, unto thee shall all flesh come. The door is open to all flesh. So, in our study, we are considering prayer for your holiness. Prayer for your holiness. Some think it's easier to get answer to prayer on other things, but for holiness of life, for perfection of life, they think it is difficult. Maybe because if you say, God, give me money, I need money to do this. After a while, you go to somebody and say, please, can you give me money? He gives, oh, God has answered my prayer. You think that it is answer to prayer that has made that person loan you some money. So it's cheaper. But holiness, some take it too difficult. As a result, they resigned to faith. Okay, it's God that will help me if I can. It's not everybody, you know, you can't finish it in this world. God knows how we are trying. So, why trying when there is a God that answers prayers? Why trying and not making it up completely and not attending to perfection completely when there is a God that answers prayers? O thou that hearest prayers, unto thee shall all flesh come. If you can come to God for sickness, you come to God for other needs of life, you come to God for oppressions, can you not come to God for holiness? That's why we're giving attention to it. That the same God can do it for you through answer to prayers. Yes. In the book of Ezekiel, Ezekiel chapter 11, Ezekiel chapter 11, verse 17. God can do the same God can do this for you. give you holiness of life, perfection of heart, if you can come to him in prayer. He will do it. Therefore, say, thus saith the Lord God, I will even gather you from the people and assemble you out of the countries where you have been scattered, and I will give you the land of Israel. And they shall come thither, and they shall take away all the detestable things thereof, and all the abominations thereof from thence. And I will give them one heart, and I will put a new spirit within you, and I will take the stony heart out of their flesh, and I will give them an heart of flesh, that they may walk in my statutes and keep my ordinances and do them, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God. But as for you, and I will be their God. Now you see the promise. You have scattered into the world. You have gone into the pollutions of the world. But I'm going to bring you back. I'm going to gather you back to myself. And those detestable things, those polluted things in your life, the corrupt dressing, the corrupt adornment, the idols, the jewelry, the palming, the women putting on strange clothes, and mean too, in your corrupt dressing, all these things, he said, I am going to take them away. It's what he said he would do. I am going to take them away. And see the promise he has made. And he said, and I will give them one heart, and I will put a new spirit within you. And I will take the stony heart out of your flesh, and will give them an heart of flesh. This is God. You say, I am an angry man. See him saying here, I will take away the angry heart out of your flesh. This is what God is promising you. You say, envy disturbs me a lot. I envy my sister. I envy my brothers. I envy my neighbor. I am going to take that envious heart out of your heart. You say, I am proud. I feel proud inside. I will take away that proud heart out of you. So which other way do you feel? I feel suspicious. I suspect my environment. I will take away the heart of suspicion that makes you're not at rest. You're always suspecting your environment. You're always suspecting the people around you. And as a result, you can't flow in righteousness with them. I will take away that heart from you, and I will give you the heart of flesh, a new heart. The heart of righteousness. The heart of holiness. I will give you. He said, and I'm going to put my spirit into your heart. You will think differently from the way you're thinking now. Because what makes you the way you are is the way you think. That's why you are the way you are. The way you think, all your thoughts are full of witchcraft. The things witches and wizards do, The things they say like this, they say like that. And because of that, it is affecting your faith in Christ. You feel prayer is not enough. Some physical thing has to be done. And that is why the temptation to collect charm always comes to you, is because of the way you think. It is because we, your eyes, your heart is always thinking on women, women, women. That's why the lusting is following. You see, oh, look at another one coming over there. Okay, look at another. Oh, see this one. I'll see this one. It's because of the way you think. He said, but I don't know how I can do. He said, I will take away that heart that is always thinking on women. I remove it. Where would that be lust again? Where would that be? Where would there be masturbation again? I said, I will do it. I'm talking about prayer for your holiness. Can you see the promise of God now? Can you see? This is what he said he would do for your life. See him talking about it again in Ezekiel chapter 37, chapter 36 rather, verse 25 to 27. He said, then will I sprinkle clean water upon you, and ye shall be clean from all your filthiness, and from all your idols will I cleanse you. Can you see that? Then, I'm taking a step in your life. I'm going to sprinkle clean water. It is the water of God's word. I'm going to lead you to my word. I'm going to cause you to hear the true word, so that by hearing it, you can be cleaned. Wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed to the word of God. By paying attention to the word of God. I'm not talking about the word they preach somewhere, which don't talk about your holiness. They only talk about prosperity. They talk about this. Oh, deliverance. They talk about this. No, I'm talking about holiness now. I'm going to cause you to hear the word of holiness. Where those disturbances are that are talking about prosperity, which is not the thing you need, and has not been working because it's not based on my total truth, I will take you to a place where I will sprinkle clean water of the word of God into you. And that way you will hear the word of holiness. And I shall clean you from all your filthiness, dirty life, dirty dressing, dirty behavior, dirty thoughts. I get you cleansed from there. And he still repeats the same thing in verse 26. He said, and a new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you, and I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you an heart of flesh. Can we say amen to this?
Amen.
This is God saying, this is the correct God, the true God, the God of righteousness and holiness, the God of heaven. Then why would you be charging him that his commandments for heaven are too grievous? Why will you say his demand is too strong? See what the man say God says he will do for you. If he does all this, which commandment is too strong? He said, I'm going to give you a new heart. A new heart that will be able to do this. In fact, a heart that looks like machine. Amen.
Amen?
A heart that Satan shall not have power to control it.
Amen.
I'm going to put into you a driver, and the driver is my spirit.
Amen.
I am going to cause you, I'm going to be foiling you, so that you will be able to keep my statutes and my laws and my word and perform them. I'm going to bring a car to you that will take you there. I'm going to bring a driver that will drive you there. And I'm going to fuel that car until it reaches there. Clap hand for Jesus, I tell you. Amen. Is there iniquity with God? If you don't make this righteousness, will you blame God? See what he has said. But just because he wants you to know that when these things are done in you, you will remember they don't come from your own principle. They don't come from your own philosophy. They don't come from your own psychology. They don't come from the books of men that are teaching science. No, they come from him. He placed this privilege, this promise in the house of prayer, waiting for you to pray. In chapter 30, in verse 37 of chapter 36, verse 37, he said, thus saith the Lord God, I will yet for this be inquired of by the house of Israel to do it for them. Can you see? That is where the difference is, my sister. Do you now know why some get this holiness and some don't? Can you see? He placed it in the house of prayer. Do you not know, my brother, why some get this holiness, some don't? Some go to meet God in the house of prayer, some don't. That is where the matter is. They go to meet with God in the house of prayer to get it there. Because he said, I am prayer answering God. Come and tell me all those things. I will handle them in your life. I will release full onus of grace upon you. I will release righteousness upon your life. You see, can you see God promising to save the sinner? Promising to give you a new heart. A heart of love. When you are full of love, envy cannot walk there anymore. Hatred cannot walk there anymore. For love overcomes multitude of sins. So, this is what God says he will do. A new heart he will give you. He is promising to perfect you. Perfect your heart of holiness. Give you a heart of obedience. He is promising to perfect you. Just make you complete the way he desires. Be ye perfect. Even as my Father, which is in heaven, is perfect. For your information, meaning method. Paul said, see me. You have not stressed fault in my life. For your information, not even in the private. God has not seen it also. See it, Noah was a just man and perfect in all his days. See it, Enoch walked with God and was not, for God has taken him. For before God translated him, but before his translation, he has this good report that he walked perfectly with God. So you see, have you considered my servant Job a perfect and an upright man? One that hates evil, loves righteousness. So the people are there up to our day. And we who are preaching to you, we don't hide it. We tell you the Lord gives us grace. It's not a historical God. Jesus the same yesterday, today, and forever. He gives us grace to live this life that we do not carry condemned conscience. In either private sin, public sin. No. This is the gospel we are preaching. It is through this prayer. We go to him every day. We cry to him every day. Oh Lord, help me. God, I don't want to shame you. God, I don't want to fall. Oh Lord, I don't want to lose out. Help. And he answers because this is his promise. See the promise of God for you. Yeah? And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and ye shall keep my judgments and do them. All these restitutions, you are thinking they're difficult. God says, I am going to put a kind of a spiritual grace in you. No restitution will be difficult. Amen. And when you make up your mind to go, I will go with you and perform it for you. Amen. That's God. Then which thing will be keeping you anymore? He said, I committed immorality. How will I go and I confess it? Many have confessed it and are sitting down peaceful now. It's you who have not gone to him. I stole from the government. What can I do? Many have stolen much from the government and have settled with the government. In fact, some went, they say, you are forgiven. God went and told the government, forgive this my son. And they said, okay, you are forgiven. He's peaceful. Are you hearing me? It is you who have not gone to the house of prayer. You have not met with God in prayer, that is sitting down and say, hey, it's too difficult. Who can follow? It's you, because you have not gone to where people obtain grace. The problem is with you. My commandments are not grievous. I will perform them for you. I will put my spirit within you and curse you. I will curse you, which means I'm going to push you like this. I'm going to be the one to kindle it. But go and come and meet with him and receive grace. Come and ask him to start. You will see all those things possible. You're the one hiding your witchcraft. Many have come to God and he has handled their case. All this, I am ashamed, people will know. God will take away shame from your life. Amen. For he that believes in the name of the Lord shall not be ashamed. Amen. I'm telling you, see how peaceful righteousness is. See how abundantly it is available. It's you. It's you. In other words, God is saying, I will give you my spirit and give you my grace and put my power of righteousness within you that will cause you to live your life without offending me. Is it clear now? Is it amplified now? I will do it. I will do it. Doesn't God know that you need the grace from him to live a righteous life? Doesn't God know that without him you cannot do anything? You cannot help yourself. You cannot deliver yourself. Does he not know? Doesn't God know that you need to fight against temptations in order to keep a clean heart? Does he even not know the types of temptation that come? The temptation that overcome you in masturbation. Temptation that comes, makes you to take some things that are not yours, stealing even. Temptation that comes and makes you, before you know it, you have told lies. Doesn't God know that you are overtaken in temptation? That even temptation, that temptation is coming next year. The temptation to remove you from the faith is still on the way next year. He doesn't know. Doesn't God know that what the devil is planning to strike in your life next month? Doesn't he know? Doesn't God know that men are tempted? Women are tempting. Men are tempting to women. Women are tempting to men. Money is tempting to everybody. That things around are tempting. Yes, he knows. All these troubles around you, but wants you to pray to him about them. Is it too costly to pray? If you are sick today, will you not be lying down? If the hospital admits you, will you not be on the bed? Then what makes you too busy to pray to God for your holiness? Just come to me. You can't come. Come to me. If you come 2 minutes, 5 minutes, you say, oh God, I need to go somewhere. This type of people. Can you see the whole thing? So, what makes you? Thus saith the Lord God, I will yet for this, for the temptations of your life, wait for you in the house of prayer. I will, for the temptations that will be coming on your way, I will be waiting for you in the house of prayer. I will yet for this be inquired of. I'm waiting for you to come and tell me how you feel, how you see. I'm waiting for you in the house of prayer. Here, God is saying, with all these promises I have made, I am expecting the children of Israel to tell me to do it for them because of my attribute as a prayer answering God. Are you people not also understanding with me? I said, I don't want this part of myself to be lying in darkness. I am the God that answers prayers. Are you people not hearing what I am saying? That I am interested in prayer so that this part of myself should also shine. It is part of my being. That's why I say you should come and pray. You still want to, don't want to satisfy me. I will yet for this. If you refuse, we're here in a stand. The temptation will carry you away. The devil will come with his plan and carry you away. I can't lose myself because of you. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. I can't lose myself. I can't lose my nature. I can't compromise because of you. No, rather let others learn from you that when they see you damned in hell, they will remember these were people that refused to pray to God. That's all. Otherwise, what stops you from prayer? What stops you from creating an hour of prayer? What stops you from spending a whole day of prayer? What stops you from going into prayer and fasting before the Lord? What stops you from bombarding him with prayer? What stops you? That's the question. That's what God is asking. Thank God. The disciples said, Lord, teach us to pray. He responded and said, after this manner, that's after you have worshipped God in heaven, then say, give us this day our daily bread. After you have worshipped God. Look at it in the book of Luke. Luke chapter 11. I read from verse 1. Luke 11, verse 1. You read verse 1. Let's read as far as to verse 4. And it came to pass that as he was praying in a certain place, when he ceased, one of his disciples said unto him, Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples. And he said unto them, when ye pray, say, can we go 1, 2, 3? Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as in heaven, so in earth. Give us this day, day by day, our daily bread. And forgive us our sins. For we also forgive everyone that is indebted to us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil one. Honor the Father, hallowed the Father, then go on to present your request. Give us this day our daily bread. Does God not know that you need to eat food? Why is he asking you that? Tell me, please ask me in the morning, ask me at any time for your daily bread. Does he not know? He keeps your food and waits for you to pray. The food is in his hand. He said, ask me for your food and I will give you. Does God not know that you are feeling headache? That you are feeling sick? He keeps your medicine, your healing, and waits for your prayer. Does God not know that the enemy is attacking? He keeps the victory and waits for you to pray. In fact, sometimes he expects your prayer to fill a bottle before answer starts gushing out for you. Sometimes it's no. You know, you can buy something with small money, but some things will require more money. Some little prayers can settle some things, but some things will need much prayer. He puts a bottle there. Just be praying. Just be praying. Look at it in the book of Psalm 56, verse 9. Psalm 56, verse 9. The Bible tells us, saying, when I cry unto thee, then shall my enemies turn back. This I know, for God is for me. In Revelation, we were told that there were bottles full of the tears of the saints. And when they were poured down upon the enemy, it was a great thing, a great weapon. God wants you to pray. He wants your prayer to fill your tears, fill a bottle. Yes, let your prayer come to the point that will be equal to Satan, equal to the power Satan has exerted against you. But you're so weak. You're even nonchalant about it. You're not generating prayers, accumulating prayers. Now, I feel to stop here, you gain something today. Something entered into you today. I'm persuaded your prayer life has changed. Amen. Your eyes have opened. Amen. You are now, just as God said, and give me no rest. Amen. From today, no rest for God. Amen. He said the thing is in his hand, that you should come and collect it from there. Even if he closed his hand, please, take your hand and say, open, open, Lord, open, give it, open, open. That's prayer. So, receive grace. Amen. Go and pray. Amen. I am sure answers are waiting for you. Amen. Thank God for this wonderful revelation. Grace.